Bible says, if you obey sin, which lead to death, you are a slave of sin. If you obey righteousness, which lead to life, you are a slave for righteousness. May we become slave of righteousness in Jesus' name. Eve obeyed. Unmasking the mask enemy. He took them so sporadically because the Bible says he has but a short time. Revelation. You read chapter 12 verse 10. You read chapter 12 verse 11. It says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Our victory over Satan is in the blood. Listen, that is why in the book of Exodus, before the children of Israel will leave the land of Gishon and leave, and never to save Pharaoh and his idol, God commanded, put the blood on the doorpost in the night when they are killing the firstborn. The Bible says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. The blood. He knew the power that the blood of Jesus will have over him. That is why, whilst he was a child, he wanted to kill him. The blood. Revelation 1, verse 5. And to him that loved us and washed us from our sins with what? His own blood. I love it this way. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. That is why when sin came, immediately God gave the promise of a Messiah. Genesis 3 verse 15. That one day the seed of the woman would destroy the works of the enemy. I want to hear an amen here. Amen. Dear friends, he is anti the blood. He doesn't love the blood of Jesus. That is why the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, is there any among us who seek? He says, by his stripe we are healed. What do you say, amen there? There is power in the blood. But Satan is a relentless foe. What did I say? He's a what? A relentless foe. He doesn't give up. He's never ashamed. His shame box was broken in the market in broad daylight. No shame. You disgrace him right now, the next time he's still coming. You embarrass him, he will still come. He will wait for you, even years. He's a shameless angel. Look, a whole angel. I hate him. A whole angel. You reduce yourself so low, and all you could do is to make young boys and girls have sex. A whole angel. That is his business now. Look at an angel. Reduce yourself. All you could do is to make a small boy in Calabar should steal food. That is all. A whole angel. A whole angel. What a shame. The third, or technically the fourth, in command of the entire creation of God, reduce to this, unmasking the masked enemy. Look at this one. Revelation. I'm talking about chapter 12. Listen to what the Bible says. And I'm reading from chapter 12, from verse 13 down. It says, after he tried, watch it carefully. Point number one, Michael fought him and defeated him. So he's a warlike man. He's anti-peace. He's anti-progress. He's anti-tranquility. And when he did not succeed, he chased the woman's child. When he did not succeed in killing the woman's child, see what he has started. He accused the brethren. He does all these. Look at his shameless approach again. And he went. And when the dragon, saw that he had been cast down upon the earth, he began to pursue who? I didn't hear that. He began to pursue who? Who had given birth to the male child? The woman. The church. And the Bible says, but she was given two great eagle's wings to fly in the desert, where she is kept safe from the serpent for a time and a time and half a time. What a mighty God we serve. Listen, before I go into a prophetic implication, Satan may harass you, Satan may attack you, Satan may worry you, but here is the case. In the process of pursuing you, in the process of worrying you, in the process of disturbing you, the Bible say God gave the woman two wings of an eagle. You know, in Exodus 19 verse 4, when Israel was brought out of slavery in Egypt, the Bible says God took them on an eagle's wing. In Deuteronomy chapter 32, you read verse 11, the Bible says, and as an eagle stretched up her nest. It means that God provided safety. Listen, in the midst of your trials, in the midst of your persecution, in the midst of your distress, in the midst of your marital unrest, in the midst of economic instability, in the midst of your academic unrest, God will provide a safety place for you. Will you say an amen there? Don't worship Satan. Never. Never. Watch it. When the going gets tough, God provides safety. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, you see, when you read the Bible so carefully, Satan attempted. In fact, when you check, these were the days in the dark ages. I will deal with this prophetic deeper insight next week. It was the time when they persecuted the church and Christians must run to Cappadocia, the Waldensians, they were being chased by the enemy, and they were there when the Bible said a time and a times and half a time. It means 3.5 years. And if there are 30 days in 12 months in a year, 12 times or 12 times 3.5 is going to give you what we call 42 months. You multiply the 42 months across times the number of days is going to give you what we call 1260 days. And that, if translated by the year prophecy period of Ezekiel, it means for 1260 years from 538 and to 1798, I will deal with that next week. Satan was harassing the church. There was no Bible. He made sure they bought all this book. They sent them into the Mediterranean Sea. That is when error started. And guess what? Go to the next verse. You understand what I mean? And when the serpent was cast out, he saw that God prepared a place for the woman. He took the next step. He spewed out water from his mouth, which could represent false doctrine, which could represent military instigation of the Christian church. God provided a safety. He went to the next step. My point is this. The book of Revelation is saying, and when he spewed out the water, his agenda, he want to destroy. His agenda, he want to kill. His agenda, he want to make life unbearable. Why do you want to love this wicked angel? He doesn't mean you well. The book of Revelation is making it so plain. Satan never gives up. He hates you. He wants you destroyed. He wants me destroyed. Wherever you are listening from, Satan never loves you. He never loves me either. He is an enemy. He's not a friend. So he spilled out water again to kill the woman. And listen to what the Bible says. Revelation 12 verse 15. And the earth helped the woman. And the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. Will you shout an amen there?
Amen.
When he does his best, God has the final say.
Amen.
He can't kill you. He can't destroy you. He can't intimidate you. He may cause you bruises, but the last say is in the hand of the Creator. Satan is a creature. I won't worship him never in my life. Never will I worship him. He is a wicked guy. I love the way the Bible put it. But guess what? He never gives up. Look at it. He attempted to usurp God's authority. Michael fought him. He came to attack the woman's seed. He was saved. God took him up to heaven. He chased after the woman. Look, Revelation is making one point. And the case tonight is simple. Satan is a killer. Heaven, the woman's child, he chased the woman. God gave the woman safety. No, he followed with water. God opened the mouth. The earth sank the water. Guess what he did again? Revelation chapter 12, verse 17. And the dragon was rough, very angry. With who? The woman. The woman represents the Christian church. He was angry with the church. During the dark ages, they refused to follow his false teachings, and he went to make war with the remnant of a seed. Who are they which keep the commandments of God and they have the faith or the testimony of Jesus? Look at this. I paraphrase it this way. The devil was angry. After not succeeding in killing the woman, after not succeeding in killing the woman's child, after not succeeding in killing the woman's creator, he's now after the remnant of the woman's seed. The last day church. They keep the commandment of God. You shall have no other God before me. He's angry with those who say, you shall not make for yourself a calf image. You shall not bow down to them. He's angry with those who say, you shall not take the name of the Lord in vain. He's angry with those who say, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. He's angry with those who say, honor your father and your mother. He's angry and wrath with those who say, you shall not murder. He's angry with those who say, don't commit adultery. He is angry with those who believe you must not steal, even if you are hungry. He's angry with those who say, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's property. Ladies and gentlemen, Satan is anti-godly people. Those he doesn't disturb are those who are his friends. Are you his friend? Are you Satan's friend? If you're his friend, can you wave at me? If you hate him like I do, can you give Jesus a round of applause? He hates men who are like Job. Men, the Bible bore a record that they are blameless. He doesn't like good people. Good people suffer. Good God, bad world. He destroyed. Sabians destroyed Job's property. He made sure they destroyed the Chaldeans. Plunged his camel into the treasure. His 10 children die in one day. Listen to me tonight. Even good people, most righteous people, they suffer in the hands of God. Job didn't know that Satan was responsible. He was blaming God. He said, the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Satan was responsible. A governor was reduced to this. Satan was responsible here in Nigeria. When people who are godly here in Africa, here in the world, when they are sick, then we need to go to some palm readers. We go to some fake pastors. We go to some witches who are using the Bible. I want to announce tonight, according to God's word, even good people, they suffer. I want you to say an amen there. I won't go anywhere for anybody to use the spirit of Okron on me. When I have a problem, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From hence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. Would somebody say an amen there? I am here to say tonight, the Lord may allow difficulties to come your way to show your loyalty and your love. But Satan is responsible. He's responsible. God says, for me, I have loved you with an everlasting love. God did not bring problems in the life of Job. He didn't bring sin into our world. Satan was responsible. Jesus said, a sower went to sow. As I wrap up tonight, Revelation will say, the problem of our world, the chaos, the addiction, the brutality, the cruelty, the deception, the emptiness, the frivolity, the gruesomeness, the homicide, the killing, the illness, the mammonness, it's from Satan. But Jesus said, Matthew 13, verse 27 to 28. So the servant of the householder came and said unto him, sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? Did God not create a perfect world? And he says, whence have its stars? Where comes the pain, the deaths, the tears, the agonies, the frustration? Where are they coming from? And Jesus said, the master answered, he said, an enemy. Boko Haram is from an enemy. Al-Shabaab is from an enemy. Sickness, death, failure, pain from an enemy. In the book of Luke, Jesus went to church, Luke 13:16, and he saw a woman. And he healed the woman, and the Pharisees blamed him. And Jesus said, so ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom who has bowed? I didn't hear that. Who has bowed? Satan. Satan has bowed. Think of it. How many years? 18 years. She was sick for 18 years. And the Bible says, who was responsible? Satan. Jesus faced his temptations. He came that he can save us. He came that he can give us hope. He came that all we see in the world today, my brothers and sisters, the one responsible for a deluded world like this is none other But Satan, my dear brothers and sisters, sin will deceive, sin will disappoint, sin will dominate, but God has the final answer. That is why he sent Jesus, that he can die, that we can be saved from the gruesomeness of the enemy, from the pain of the enemy. When he died on Sunday, the angel of the Lord descended from heaven, his countenance with lightning, and the Bible says his clothing was like snow. And the angel answered and told they were looking for him. Matthew 28 verse 6, it says, do not be afraid. He is not here. He is risen. He has risen from the grave. When Jesus died in Colossians, the Bible says in Ephesians 2 verse 15, he said he disarmed the enemy. He took away the weaponry of Satan. Remember, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts who are in heavenly places. Jesus is my God. He's the King of righteousness. He's the King of the ages. He's the King of heaven. He's the King of glory. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is God's son. He is the sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone in himself. He is aghast. He is unique. He is unparalleled. He is unprecedented. He is the one who is supreme. He is preeminent. He's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He is the highest knowledge in higher criticism. He is the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the cardinal point of spiritual religion. Jesus, he said, I stand at the door and I know. Jesus, he's the miracle of the age. He's our Michael. He can defeat the enemy. He's the superlative of anything we can call good. He's the only one who is able to supply all our needs simultaneously. He's available to the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and saves. He guards and guards. He heals the sick. My Jesus is able to do all. He is the key to knowledge. He is the wellspring of wisdom. He is the doorway of deliverance. He is the pathway of peace. He is the highway of holiness. He is the gateway of glory. He is the master of the mighty. He is the captain of the conquerors. He is the head of the heroes. He is the leader of legislature. He oversees and overcomes. He is the governor of governors. He is the prince of peace, and he is the Lord of law. He cleans the lepers. He forgives the sinners. He discharges the debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the younger. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent, and he beautifies the weak. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we have a choice to make between two leaders. Tonight the choice is between either we choose Jesus or we choose Satan. I want a decision tonight. We're going to sing this song, On a Hills Far Away. When we are singing that song, you have a choice to make a decision between two masters. If you want to vote for Jesus, you stand on your feet. I'm not asking everybody to stand. Those who really want to serve this Jesus, if you know the song, you can join us. For a while, wherever you are, in your home, in your office, wherever you may find yourself through this live streaming, do you love Jesus? Make a choice for him today. Do you love Jesus? Make a decision for him today. My prophecy, one day I will cling to the old rugged cross. One day I was chained for a bride. This is the death he has died. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world. It is despised. Today the world has chosen for Jesus. Will you believe it? I love the cross. I love the cross. That was when the Lamb of God died. He died. He left all his glory. Even to Calvary, so that he can save you in Nigeria. He can save you in Africa. He can save you wherever you find yourself. I believe this cross.